Hello, I'm Eric Snodgrass, and thank you for watching today's long-range forecast video brought to you by Nutrien Ag Solutions. This analysis is being provided by perspective only, and any decision made based upon this presentation is the sole responsibility of the person making the decision. Finally, please remember that all long-range weather forecasting is speculative by nature. Well, we just kind of start off with a quick glance at what our winds are doing here in and around North America. Now, these are surface winds midday today on Wednesday, and what we're watching is coming out of the North Pacific, we do have a few systems that are kind of stacked up here that will be invading parts of the Pacific Northwest, and you're going to see that in the precipitation anomaly map I'm about to show you. We do have a low-pressure system that's trying to develop in the central part of the United States, and through early this morning, parts of Oklahoma and Kansas have been seeing some light snow. But to the south of it, we've had some rain. There is a coastal low that's sitting and spinning here just off the southeast coast, and thankfully, because of the presence of this high-pressure cell, it's not going to be causing too much of an issue here. But things have been very dry along coastal Carolinas, getting down into southern Georgia and then into Florida as of late. So some of that precipitation could have been beneficial had it been able to get a little bit farther to the east and hit the coast. But as we look at our all hazards weather map today, this is what we're currently looking at. We have a winter weather advisory over a large section of the mid part of the United States, and still a wind chill advisory down here in the southeast, really into Florida, and then things are still quite chilly down here for this time of year. We've got some flood issues going on in and around the Puget Sound, Seattle, Tacoma region, and some big snows that could potentially be piling up in the northern part of the Cascade Mountain Range. But if we just step back and take a look at what we're anticipating, this is just going through Saturday morning. So looking at over the next 3.5 days, with the two main features we talked about. So the first set of systems coming into the Pacific Northwest, we're adding quite a bit of rainfall here to coastal Oregon and Washington. Remember, high pressure still occupying here, keeping much of this precipitation from getting into Southern California. As this next low very slowly emerges because of how strong those upper level winds are in the trough, we could see, just if we kind of outline a region here, okay, we could see in the northern half of that area between 1/2 of an inch and in some locations approaching 3/4 of an inch to an inch of liquid equivalent. And we're going to talk about the snow that'll be up here in just a few moments. But then on the south side, we are adding quite a bit of precipitation into this corridor and again through here as the system moves forward. And that's important to look at and understand the context, because the heavier precipitation that is moving slowly through this area, well, you can see that over the last couple of weeks here, we're anywhere between 300 and 500 plus percent of normal on precipitation. So very wet. In fact, if you just kind of draw a dividing line here and kind of cut off some of the coastal regions, we've been extremely wet inside that corridor. Southern California, very, very dry, but parts of the Pacific Northwest where we have more precipitation coming in, we have over the last couple of weeks been between 150 and 200 percent of normal on precipitation. So this is kind of the key feature here, and I'll just let you know, let me back these drawings off, the soil moisture content underneath the circle I just drew there, inside the circle I drew there, is very high, and I'm quite concerned about the spring flooding threat, especially here in the North Central Plains as we move out of our winter forecast time period into spring, but still that's several weeks away, so something I want to keep a close eye on. A lot of this next system, we got an interesting look at the snowfall. So I'm going to show you first what NOAA is projecting here. So this is the probability of accumulating at least 2 inches of snow, and you can see the probability legend down here. So probability of getting at least 2 inches of snow through Saturday morning. If we step this up to 4 inches, though, we can see that NOAA is kind of honing in on a path right in through here that has the greatest snowfall amounts. And why I'm saying this is interesting is because take a look at what the models are saying. I've kind of zoomed in here in the central United States, and this is what the European model is picking up on through Saturday morning. Now, as they have the higher amounts tucked away in this part of Missouri, what we have to keep a very close eye on here is what our temperatures are going to do, because this is using a 10-to-1 snow ratio, and that may not be a valid snow ratio in that area. But take a look at this. Just in your mind, let's just remember that the European wants to keep this area with having the best chances of at least getting at least 3 inches of snowfall. Now, going over to the GFS, the main difference here is the same time period. This goes through Saturday morning, with why they have the broadest and heaviest snows, basically stretching from like Lincoln and Omaha here through northwestern Iowa, then into northern Wisconsin, rather than filling in this area, is because the European model brings the low pressure center through here. The GFS backs the low much farther to the north and west, therefore carrying more warm air with it. This is, I mean, I know this is only just the next few days, but it's a very challenging forecast here in the near term. So what is the National Digital Forecast Database going with here? Well, this is, again, what NOAA would be using to issue its forecasts at its National Weather Service offices. And while they have this same general area as the European in terms of where the snowfall is going to happen, you can see that they're trying to pick out possibly southern and central Iowa as having the greatest snowfall amounts, where we might get over 6 inches. And if I just back this up, let's just go back again, we see that that seems to be the region that NOAA is picking up on as well with their probability maps, and also heavier snowfall here in north central Wisconsin getting into the UP. So we needed to do a blend of these models, and I hate to say it, but I'm most skeptical of the GFS right now, just given how far to the north and west the system is. It's still a possibility, but other models are suggesting otherwise. So let me show you this system here. So this is, we're going to go to the European, start this off early this morning. We'll pause it right there because you can see this is going to be a long duration event. This is Wednesday night, getting into Thursday morning, Thursday afternoon and evening, and now getting into Friday morning, Friday afternoon and evening, and getting in now into Saturday morning, afternoon and evening. So because this system lacks the strong winds to have the low eject and move into the northeast quickly, we've got a 3-day window inside this corridor that we're going to see quite a mix of precipitation. And you notice, again, more snow on the backside. I think the most challenging forecast for the precipitation type will be my home state of Illinois as this system pulls through, especially on Friday morning. We're trying to figure out, is it going to be I-55? That's going to be the main kind of border here for the rain snow line. It's going to be a challenging one. But depending on how far east that goes, we'll tell you what kind of precipitation we're going to get and how much potential snow might fall. So this could be a system that what we often say outperforms itself. In other words, it because of its slow nature and its nearly, you know, deep supply of moisture, it has the shot at doing some heavier snowfall amounts on the backside of this. So I want to watch this one carefully as we progress toward the end of this week, and I'll give you a brand new update early tomorrow morning. Now, I want to just play this forward to show you what the pattern continues to do. You're going to watch the Pacific Northwest, and I want you to keep seeing systems sweep out of here. I'll leave my drawings on there as we go forward. So watch this again. Whoops, sorry. Watch this again here. System 1 goes out. Notice the Pacific Northwest continue to see systems, and now another one emerges in the central United States as we progress out into day 7, 8, 9, and 10. We just aren't slowing this pattern down anytime soon, and that's why, now you can see it here, the week 2 forecast pattern continues to bring those systems here out of the Gulf of Alaska, but California stays on the drier side here in the week 2 forecast, and it's largely because there's a high pressure cell due to some split flow in the atmosphere I'm going to show you in a few moments going around that high pressure cell there just off the west coast. Underneath it comes the stronger subtropical jet stream, and what that's doing is it's keeping much of the eastern third, two-thirds or half of the country on this active pattern with seeing multiple systems coming through. So we just aren't shaking what we've been dealing with. So now what I want to do is I want to try to explain a little bit why. You see, as I look out over the next 10 days, I notice a few important things. First of all, the jet stream coming off of Japan, as we've been talking about, is very strong. It wants to split here into a northern branch and a stronger subtropical branch doing this. And what we want to do is we want to understand what that flow pattern means for not only our longer range precipitation forecast, but our temperatures as well. Because right now, the two areas that I want everyone to focus on, if you're in North America the most, is going to be what's happening over Alaska and what's happening over Greenland. You can see by the color shading here that both regions, in fact, this extends into the North Atlantic very clearly, both regions here are experiencing troughing. So if we've got colder air tucked into the corners here of North America, what that means is that any trough that sweeps through the central United States isn't anchored to that really, really cold air, which means all we get are brief shots at some cooler weather. This does not mean that, you know, that we're not going to still see winter precipitation. We just showed evidence of that. But what I'm talking about here is the lack of a source of brutally cold air, at least for the next 10 to 15 days. So we've seen this over the last month, and I've been showing this multiple times, but where our coldest air has been locked away has been here, stretching from Alaska through parts of British Columbia and over into Alberta. And then even though we have seen at times cold air sneak out like this and eventually get all the way to the coast, you can't outdo the longer term pattern, which has kept the eastern half of North America on the warmer side of things. Here's the other piece. It's cold here and it's cold in through there compared to normal. And I want to make a case for why I think over the next 10 to 15 days, we continue to see this pattern. But I'll tell you what to be watching for when it changes. So over days 1 through 5, so right over here, we continue to see the cold tucked away in these regions and above average temperatures start to really gain a foothold here in the Canadian provinces that surround the Hudson Bay. Now remember, even though you do see temperatures here that may be as much as 5 to 10 degrees above average, that does not mean it's going to be warm there. This is compared to average. It's still very, very cold in that area. But overall, we would call this a more moderate pattern for the majority of North America. Getting out here to days 5 through 10, again, just notice with me where the coldest air is located. So the chances through the next 10 days, and even taking you out to the next 15 days, of having sustained cold in the lower 48 and in eastern parts of Canada is relatively low. Now, one thing I want to stress with you is I want you to look at this bullet point I've written up here. I'm going to put together for you a string of ideas about our global teleconnections. And I want you to remember that on any given day, the relationship between these teleconnections and weather patterns downstream, for example, which could be over the United States, well, those correlation coefficients are generally very weak. They're most times less than negative 0.3 or 0.3. So they sit somewhere closer to zero. But collectively, they can constructively or deconstructively interfere. And right now, I would say they are constructively interfering. In other words, what's going on in the polar vortex? What's going on in the North Atlantic? What's going on in the North Pacific? These three features are all additive to give cold over Alaska and cold over Greenland, and therefore a more relaxed pattern across the rest of North America. Global winds are quite strong, and I'll see the effect of that in a few minutes. And while we don't have a real strong El Nino or La Nina, we do have some warm water in the Central Pacific to be discussing. Sierra Southern Oscillation Index, though, is negative, but it's not strongly negative, which says, hey, we don't have sustained ocean pressure patterns that tell us that El Nino or La Nina is going on. And I think a bigger feature here is this zonal splitting Pacific jet stream that we seem to not be able to shake in the forecast time period. So it comes down to this bullet point. Through the next 10 plus days, I think it's difficult for us to get sustained cold air to set up here in the lower 48. And I think we're going to have to watch Greenland, Alaska as our major indicators. Here's the details on that. Polar vortex right now, very strong, quite steady. And relatively stable as we go through the end of this week and into next week. Where it sits compared to normal, we'll just remember that on this graph, going up kind of gives us the relative strength of the polar vortex, and it's currently sitting right here. And as I've been pointing out, a year ago, it was way down here on the chart. So the point here is just to say that we don't have a disrupted polar vortex at this point that could aid in any sort of cold air outbreaks that could happen across North America. Let's add to it this. In the North Atlantic and in the North Pacific, we tend to watch these two features, the North Atlantic Oscillation and the East Pacific Oscillation. As you can see in the graphics here, both are forecast through the next 10 to 15 days to stay in positive territory. Whenever we typically get more sustained cold, in other words, we break down the cold over Alaska and Greenland, these two features tend to dip way down here in the graphics. But as we look out over the next 10 days, we just tend to hang on to those troughs. So no real high latitude blocking here. And any trough, again, that sweeps through the lower 48 isn't anchored to that bitterly cold air. Going on to another idea here. We've seen that over the last 15 to 20 days, our global angular momentum, this is basically a measure of how fast the atmosphere is moving as the planet rotates, well, it's really shot up into positive territory here. And generally when that happens, we get a very strong zonal jet that comes across the Pacific off of Asia, and it often leads to splitting like you see here over the west coast of the United States. This is what's directing those storm systems out of the Gulf of Alaska where the trough is sitting into the northwest, but avoiding California. Also, this stronger subtropical branch right down here that I'm kind of running over, that is something that is going to push against any sustained cold coming into the southeastern part of the United States. So you see how these things are additive, they're working together. Next piece of this, I want to keep a close eye on the warmth that you see right here in the Central Pacific between Hawaii and Australia, for example. We've noticed that in this region, so this is Niño Region 3.4, we have been above average on our ocean temperatures. And I made a point to share with you down here that beneath that box, deep into the ocean, I don't see any cold water that could just emerge and knock this out. But this is by no means an El Nino signal. I mean, we can see the colder air tucked up against South America here. And even though we keep getting these westerly wind bursts, which we would typically see in an El Nino, they're being matched with some stronger trade winds on the other side. And this is tending to push quite a bit of tropical convergence right into where I'm drawing this X and a lot of thunderstorms. And that's releasing a lot of heat into that area. We can see that over the next 15 days. Right in through here is where we're tending to get a lot of our tropical convection. And that particular feature is important. I'm going to remove the drawing to show you this. You see, we tend to see our wettest conditions doing this. And that tells me that the heat transport out of the tropics seems to be one of the more dominant features to be watching right now. Let's add one more piece to this. Remember, the warm phases for the eastern half of North America on the MJO are 4, 5, and 6, with the colder phases here of 7, 8, 1, and 2. What's our MJO doing? Well, it spent a bunch of time in January over here in 5, 6, and it's now currently sitting in 7, and forecast to go into null phase and then back out over here into 5 or 6 again. Now, if for some reason, and it's a possibility, but if for some reason the MJO does sneak out down here temporarily into phase 2, or maybe even comes out into phase 1, well, that could be a part of the change, because I want to make one point here. If we've got all of these teleconnections, these broad-scale features of flow across the world constructively working together now, if one of them begins to fall out of line, it might lead to kind of a cascading event. So we're going to watch all these things very carefully. But if we put them all together, what the long-range European model is suggesting for February is you can see the colder-than-average conditions hanging on in Alaska. You see them here in Greenland and stretching into the North Atlantic. What it suggests here is that if we do get some colder air, because that flow is doing something like this, okay, we could possibly push it at times just in quick hitting kind of lobes of cooler air that come into that region. That's what the European model is saying, although I've seen some trends not only in this model but also in the CFS to continue to make this a less and less likely event in here. So we just, you know, we got to watch this one carefully, because overall, while things are adding up right now, I wouldn't necessarily say that they're stuck. So again, that's your temperature pattern through the month of February. It is quite a bit different from what NOAA is saying. And if I could just back these drawings off of here, NOAA's latest forecast wants to keep this side of the continent much above average and drop in the cooler weather here. So I can't buy into that right now simply because these teleconnections are not advertising that at all. So I'm going to tell you what I want you to watch here, okay? If there's any shift in the high latitude blocking, in other words, if we get ridges building over Greenland or Alaska, throw it out the window, the pattern will shift and we will see a return for some serious winter conditions in February if that happens. If there's anything like a sudden stratospheric warming event that can disrupt that polar vortex, toss this forecast out. If the MJO fails to regain phase 4, 5, and 6 and instead emerges in phases 1, 2, or 7 and 8, we also have a tropical signal that would shift the pattern quite a bit. And we all need to watch that strong Pacific jet stream for possibly breaking a wave. In other words, where it's screaming across, if it breaks a wave, like a wave on the ocean, that could slow global winds and that could end this Gulf of Alaska split. If none of that happens, and this is a possibility, if none of that happens, we could continue to see the same pattern lasting all the way in through March into May. And therefore, this part of the country, as seen here by the European model, this part of the country, as seen by the National Multimodal Ensemble, could have, as we made a case in last week's long-range video, could have the tendency to stay wet. And this would be disadvantageous for a lot of us here planting corn in the Corn Belt. Dry west. So we have to keep a close eye on this pattern, because that split flow seems to be a pretty serious thing. To finish up, I want to show you what's going on in South America. Remember, right now we're trying to get harvest going here for first crop soybeans. There is tremendous pressure to get the safrinha crop in and get it in quickly. So any rain inside this area that I'm kind of highlighting here could be detrimental to getting that first crop out. South of there, over the next week, we do see drier than average conditions setting up in parts of southern Brazil, but really in Argentina. And why I'm starting to get concerned here is that while I don't see major heat stress, it seems to continue into week two. Now, this will be very impactful because in Argentina, they still need another 45 to 60 days to get crops to finish and to mature there. And if we are at this critical time stage where things are very dry, this could start to pull back on some of the yield potential in parts of Argentina. Meanwhile, about the most important trend I've seen in week two, that's the map that's over here on the right, is that the models are advertising back over toward near average to wetter than average conditions. So as I said, in this area, if we do go back over to wet, it could delay the harvest of the first crop of soybeans. And don't forget, we were 2 to 3 weeks delayed in planting those beans compared to a year ago. So South America is dealing with some tight windows right now in terms of getting first crop out and second crop in. And there's consensus down there that they want to get that second crop in fast. There's reason to get that corn and cotton crop in. I'll finish up with this last map. The long-range European model for the month of February is favoring the northern growing regions here in South America to be wet. And this will be very important to watch because it may impact harvest efforts of first crop beans in through here. Also notice this. Same models wanting to keep Argentina dry. So we have some important things to keep an eye on down here as we look at our global models in South America. So with that, I'm going to go and wrap this one up. Hope you all have a great end to your week. We'll talk to you again very soon. Thank you.